evening and welcome to the Super License F1 podcast. My name's Rodney.
And my name is Zach.
I was waiting for, I was sitting in my head. I said, my name's Zach, but you hadn't spoken yet. So it was, there was a weird delay, but only I heard it because it was in my head. You know what I mean?
I know what you mean. Yeah. But don't worry. We'll shake it out of you because this is Shakedown.
This is Shakedown. It's not an episode of Super License. It's an episode of Super License. It's complicated. Look, there's no race. We're just going to be shaking it out this week. We're just two guys, Rod and Zach, a couple of guys who are definitely recording and have got a big old plan for this episode. First of all, Zach, sound off. How are you going?
Sound off. Yes. I was going to say that this is part of the Super License extended universe. Hmm. So it's not Super License, but it's in the same universe. So, you know, Rod and Zach on this episode, we actually exist in the same universe as the Super License F1 podcast, Rod and Zach.
You do. You'll hear us refer to things, characters. We share characters with the Super License universe. Mm-hmm. It's great. And stay tuned post credits for a big tease. Obviously, no race. So we're going to do our usual episode of Shakedown, by which I mean we're going to be looking at the Twitter poll this week. We're going to offer a content recommendation. We've got a little bit of news to catch up on. Plus, you just get to listen to us, our sparkling voices, our joyous voices, for a little while. And I don't know. That's about it. I guess I just trailed off there. Whoops.
No trouble. Like, you know, sometimes you got to trail off instead of choosing to keep fighting for position. You know, sometimes you just got to trail off back just to save everybody and so you can fight another day.
I'm saving my tires. I'm going to have a charge later in the race. I'm on a contra strategy, you could say. Okay, Zach, we should cover off the Twitter poll this week. You don't need to necessarily cast your vote yet, but just have a think about this one. This week's Twitter poll was time for a Shakedown poll in the Italian GP crash. Who was right and who was wrong? Option A, Lewis Hamilton. Option B, Max Verstappen. Completely self-explanatory. No further explanation needed. Who was right and who was wrong? You can cast your vote, Lewis Hamilton or Max Verstappen. If you're on Twitter, you've probably already done that. Twitter poll's about to close. But at the end of the episode, I will be outlining who among our Twitter followers thought was right or wrong, Lewis Hamilton or Max Verstappen. You get the chance to weigh in later, Zach, and we'll see if you were right or wrong.
Should we do a Twitter poll of whether I'm going to get it right or wrong as well, or after I said which one was actually correct, we'll go from
that. That would be a good Shakedown poll next time to be like, will Zach get this right or wrong, yes or no? Because you would have to guess about your own poll, and then hopefully, fingers crossed, you get it right.
Jeez, the brain melt. I don't know if I can follow. Yeah. That's real Doctor Strange stuff at this point, right?
Wrong universe, bro. Wrong universe.
Wrong universe.
We got any news we want to get into? Speaking about universes, who's going to be sticking around in the Aston Martin universe?
Oh, Sebastian, Uncle Formula One himself, Vettel, and Lance, my dad owns the team, Stroll.
Oh, dear. Well, I mean, no real surprises, but it's good to have confirmations anyway, and I'm sure that they're very happy. I think I read something along the lines of Vettel was only contracted for half a season, and then he got recontracted for the rest of the season and then beyond. Is that right?
I think it's definitely something around his contract had an extension clause. Like, I don't think he was contracted for next year. I think it was like, hey, if we all like each other and it's going okay and no one else comes up that's as good, we can we'll just extend you. And he was like, cool, I'd love to be a bitch.
A bit taller, a couple of inches on the top, please.
Exactly. I think that's fine.
Do you?
I heard the Box of Neutrals boys conjecting the idea that possibly things were not all fine and dandy at Aston Martin. I don't think I don't think Sebastian Vettel's that guy anymore, right? I think he's just probably a little bit like, you know, I'm really good. The car's fine, but are they taking the upward step with that? Is there just a cap maybe on how good, is there a ceiling on where Aston Martin can go now? Because, Lance Stroll's not going to be a world champion at any point. But maybe if they did get someone who was really pushing that way, say a Lando Norris and Esteban Ocon, Pierre Gasly, for example, who might really push them a little bit further and not be like, I accept that this car's not great today. Be like, no, we're going to keep going. Maybe they could actually, their aspirations might match their driver lineup, for example.
You could be right. I don't know. I don't know about Lando Norris because he's probably pretty happy at McLaren there, I would think. But if you're asking
Lando Norris type.
A Lando Norris type, like who?
Blando Norris.
Hi. His brother. Hello. Greetings, fellow children. It's me, Nando Loris.
No, Orlando Bloom. That's the
same Lando name, blue. Well, any of the Landos.
Yeah.
Basically,
Calrissian. Oh no, Calrissian. Ah.
Hand in your nerd card. I'm usually the one who stuffs up all the sci-fi references. I think if you're Aston Martin, you have to be looking at like, okay, we're not in the top three, but that's fine. We didn't think we would be, but we are in the battle for the, you know, the second tier, that sort of mid-range, the front of the midfield. They've got to be happy with that, I reckon. And then there's other teams that would be even happier. Some that are not happy, like Ferrari being like, we don't want to be back here mixing it with bloody Alpine. What even is that? We're Ferrari. But I think if you're Aston Martin, you'd be very happy to be where you're at. And I mean, the question is, are they treading water or are they on the upwards trajectory? And is Sebastian Vettel the guy that's going to keep propelling them forward? Obviously, they think right now, yes. But, you know, 1 or 2 years down the track, things could be different. The other thing I was going to say, I don't know about, I haven't heard the Boxing Neutrals episode yet, but I noticed every announcement tweet or article about the Aston Martin drivers getting signed, pull up any one of them that you like. Listen, I look, you know, whatever website you like going to, whatever Facebook group you're in, whatever, pull up the Aston Martin announcement. Look at the expression on the two drivers' faces. And man, they look like they hate each other. They look like they want to kill each other. It's like there's no photo in anybody's media bank where they're smiling or even just happy to be there. They're always sullen and frankly annoyed.
Those two have resting annoyed faces, I think. I think Vettel's always been like that. We were used to him being very smiley when he was winning all the time. And more recently, smiley just about, you know, like he's happy to be here. He likes being a dad.
True.
And Lance is smiley when like he's happy and things are going well, which is the appropriate time to be smiley. But I think that literally the rest of the time, they're neutral. Like what? I think I would constantly be like, yeah, like what? What if I was Lance Stroll's boyfriend, I would be like, are you angry at me all the time? What is going on? I need constant, like, you're not, like, you've been quiet, Lance. You've barely touched your Cheetos. What's going on?
I can't remember all of the options, but there's that matrix of like good, bad, neutral, chaotic, good. You know that
speaking matrix of nerd cards.
I feel they're definitely in the sort of chaotic neutral. They've got resting chaotic neutral face.
100%. 100%. They are both chaotic neutral, just spin for no reason. That is Sebastian Vettel, chaotic neutral. True.
Hey, I'll tell you something else about Sebastian Vettel. He pops up in the little Netflix documentary called Schumacher. Now, I've seen it. You've seen it. We're going to do a special Patreon only, or at least at the moment. Put it out for the Patreon listeners right now. Maybe down the track we'll put it out for others. I don't know. Maybe I'll feel generous one day and I'll just post it out. But for now, we're going to record a sort of a Dare to Swear-esque episode about the Schumacher documentary. But yeah, since Vettel came up, since he's topical, he pops up in the old documentary as well.
Yeah, it is good. I mean, he's one of those, he's the poster boy for the, hey, I was in a picture with you when I was a little baby, and now we race together.
Absolutely. The classic. Yeah, that's right.
How things started, how they're going, fodder.
It's like that. Everybody I was going to go with the Simpsons meme with all the kids in the school in the class looking back as if like say the line, and then it's like Fred over him as a kid with another driver, and they're all cheering. Yeah. But you know, listener, insert meme of choice there. Your mileage may vary, but that's just a call out to say that if you're a supporter of our Super License Club, Patreon, whatever we're calling it these days, keep an eye out for an email from us to say that there's a new episode out about us talking about Schumacher coming up very soon. What else is going on in the world, Zach? Any other news we need to talk about?
I don't think so. I mean, there's been a little bit of like Formula One calendar stuff. Things are still up in the air around maybe US races, especially South American races. It's very difficult right now. I think the US is on some red lists, especially at the UK's red list. And a lot of the teams are based in the UK and Europe. Europe generally is not really happy with the UK and the US right now for submarine nuclear reasons. There's all kinds of bullshit happening that Formula One gets affected by. Formula One has kind of pretended its whole last 30 years that it's kind of untouched by the political maneuverings of the world, like can kind of just go wherever and run an F1 race, where more recently it's like, shit, actually, people don't like, we're not going to be able to get everyone there, or everyone might be a bit tired when they got there, or we're not all jabbed, or are we all jabbed with the wrong jab? Is there a wrong jab? All of this kind of bullshit. And I think Formula One's getting caught up a little bit in it at the time when they were like, can we run 25 races with varying formats? We'll see on the calendar. There was one little bit of interesting news that I didn't bring up in the notes or pre-show that's just occurring to me now. which I've seen a little bit on, which is the idea of enforcing rules around running reserve drivers in free practice on Friday. So that junior drivers get exposed to Formula One more often. We see this a little bit. It tends to happen when the Formula 2 or Formula 3 is on at the same track on the same weekend as Formula 1 because the drivers are all there. So it's easier to pull in a driver and be like, hey, you should practice. But then they're also sacrificing a little bit of the race weekend. It's a bit difficult. Well, do you think that teams should have to run reserve drivers or junior drivers every race weekend at some point?
Obviously, if you're a junior driver, you want to say, yep, absolutely. But I mean, there are rookie Formula One drivers who really need that time in there. I think it would be maybe good if there was like, for the season, you have to nominate six races. So you can pick which ones, you can pick who drives in them, but six races where one of your main two drivers doesn't do practice two or one or whatever. That'd be all right.
Yeah, I think so. I like something like that. You nominate them. That's why not everyone's doing them all at the same time. There's no, you can kind of work them around your driver's schedules as well. You know, if you're, say, Red Bull Honda, maybe you want to run your young Japanese reserve driver during the Japanese race.
Japanese Grand Prix. I was thinking the exact same thing.
Oh, that's nice. See, look at that. Simpatico. Yeah.
Look at this. It's working. We're firing.
Look at this bloody thing. I agree. I think that going a little bit like you have to do them one session, do you have to like dedicate a whole session to a driver? Are you allowed to like swap a driver out mid-session? That would be fine too. Like, Bottas goes out and does 50 laps and then they're like, cool, you come in and let's give old, Oscar Piastri or whatever a bit of time in the car too.
Yeah, I guess they
give him a turn.
I see no real reason why you couldn't do that, other than the fact that it might get a bit ridiculous. You'd end up having 10 different drivers driving the car and stuff. But
that'd be a problem.
Just open up free practice.
Just let, fuck it. If Martin Brundle wants to get around and show us around in a car, let him do that.
Ah, he'd love a go. He would love to have a go.
He really would love to have a go.
He really would.
Yeah. Last bit of news that I had on my mind.
A lot of the driver seats, like we sort of covered that recently in the last few shows, a lot of the main seats are all sort of settled or we kind of know who's going to go there, et cetera. And because there was no race this week, the news is sort of slim pickings. We might just sizzle quickly that we are going to run through in a second a couple of content recommendations because, Shakedown was born out of basically, COVID lockdowns, all the rest of it. We needed something to do. We figured other people needed something to do. That's why we're listening to this. But you might also have heaps of spare time on your hands or just need something different in your life. So we're here to offer recommendations. So if that's the sort of thing that you are looking for, you can prepare yourself, get a pad and paper, or pull out your smartphone of choice and get ready to absorb whatever we're going to throw out in a second. But maybe we will close out the Twitter poll for this week. The patented superlicense Twitter poll, one of my favorite ones that we've done for Shakedown. I know that Shakedown isn't necessarily like an established thing to the degree that everybody who read this got the joke, but I was incredibly satisfied when I came up with this question and I actually debated like, does it look too legitimate and will people not understand that it's a joke because we're not necessarily like the established jokers? Like this isn't coming from WTF1 or anything like that. But this poll in the Italian GP crash, who was right and who was wrong? Option one, Lewis Hamilton. Option two, Max Verstappen. 36 votes, amazingly. 36 people read that and went, there's absolutely nothing wrong with that question. Here's my vote. Who would you go with in this option, in this choice, Zach? Who do you think was right or wrong, Lewis Hamilton or Max Verstappen?
I think Lewis Hamilton was wrong.
You think Lewis Hamilton was wrong? Well, let's see if everyone agrees with you. I can say that with a stunning 40.5% of the vote is Lewis Hamilton, and then on a dominant 59.5% of the vote, Max Verstappen. Pretty much what you would expect in terms of just an A or B choice. Each one is perfectly good. But apologies to anybody who read that and then got indignant, and then anybody said, oh, duh, it's a joke, duh. I don't think anyone meant to do anything cruel or suggest you were dumb if you didn't understand it. The whole point of it was that I'm dumb. The reason I went with this is because I think the joke is that I'm dumb and I'm okay with that because I think that's funny. Yeah. But yeah, thanks to everybody who voted. Maybe the dumbest shakedown poll we've ever done. Yeah, thoughts or comments, reactions?
Thoughts, comments, reactions. We do an instant reaction pod to your poll. Like, yeah, let's stop this recording, do another recording. Yep. Okay. How did the poll go? The poll debrief. I think that we all everybody contributed. Thought it was great that we got that much engagement. I think the impressions were good. I think my choice of response to the responses was also good.
The thing is, I think that your vote shows that you are in on the joke.
Yes, of course.
Yeah. It's an ironic vote.
Yeah, I'm all about being in on the joke.
Classic you being so ironic.
Oh, I just like being in on things. I don't like to be left out. I like to feel like I'm in the know.
It is
ITK.
Fun. Well,
I wonder how people get those ITK. Yeah. Like, would you be tempted? This is a question from me, podcast host and listener, first time caller, Rodney. Question for you: if you were,
yes, I'm ready.
In the paddock. You're a guy who is, you know, working. You run concierge for Formula One. You're an insider.
Whoa.
Okay. Would you be tempted? You know, you hear a bit of scuttlebutt. You hear all the people in the kitchens. You see the meetings. You got friends. You got inside knowledge about Formula One contracts. You know who's like and what.
Wow.
Who's coming out of whose caravans.
And who's right and who's wrong.
Yeah. Who's left, who's right. Who's hot and who's to trot. Or not, perhaps. Would you be tempted to start up one of those ITK in the know kind of Twitter feeds, you know, like Paddock Insider or, you know, F1 Know-It-All, something like, you know, the F1 Hamster. Like, would you be tempted?
I mean, probably
Rodney
for a minute.
Mr. X.
So wait a second. So in this hypothetical, do I have regular access to Insider? Ooh, okay.
Yeah, you're there. You're in the paddock every week, mate. You have a corporate F1 role, let's say, because I don't think you could be in one of the teams. I think that's difficult. But maybe, I mean, that would be a high-risk strategy, man. Like, if you're an engineer for Ferrari and you've got a Mr. X-style Twitter account, like, you might be going down.
That's the thing. But, I mean, the other opportunity that you have, other than setting up your own Twitter account, is just leaking information to other people and being like, hey, Mr. Whatever, hey, Mrs. Whomever, hey, you want to know a little bit of something? You want to know a little something about Sebastian Vettel? He used to be a kid, and there's a photo of him with other drivers. Shh. Don't tell anybody except for Netflix. You could
what do you get out of that?
Spread the word, man. Well, I mean, maybe you get something. Maybe you get money. Maybe you get treats. Mm. Maybe you get riches. I don't know. Favors.
Hey, treats and riches. I love that
as
they're on the same.
As opposed to clout. Yeah. Hey, look.
I could give you £1,000, or I could give you these 6 Trump bars. Ooh, treats. Yes.
Are you a fan of vanilla slice?
Oh, I am. Oh, how I am. Okay. So you would probably, you would go down that route, would you? The leaker.
I think, the thing is, I run enough Twitter accounts. I juggle enough accounts in my life. I don't need more accounts. You want more clout?
Yeah, you need more accountability is what you need.
I don't have enough social
clout. I'd be all over it. I'd be like, yep, here we go.
It wouldn't even be one of those secret accounts. It would just be your account. Here I am, Mr. Zachary Priest. Here's a selfie of me. Here it is. Valtteri Bottas signing a deal. Here he is. Boom.
Yeah, here he is. Again, talking to Fred.
My DMs are open.
They had lunch. Yeah, I said.
I like treats and riches.
My DMs are open. Ask me. I'll forward the questions along to Valtteri.
For encrypted tips, just slide into my DMs. It's fine.
Yeah,
I won't tell anyone. It's as good as encrypted.
Or if you say, you ever want to get in touch, spin into my DMs. It's cool.
That's amazing. Spin into my DMs. That's a hashtag. We'll get that going next time he spins.
DMs.
Yeah,
such
exactly.
Maz is
spinning your heart out.
Yeah.
Let's do some. Let's get into some content talk, Zach. Mm. This is where we offer some juicy, cool, or interesting content that we've been consuming. Could be anything. But if the listeners are also starved for content options, we're going to help them out here. This is us lending everybody a hand. Anything come to mind? You got anything on the ready?
Yeah, I got two things. I was looking for a new sci-fi or fantasy series to get into, especially because I had a little bit of holiday recently. And one of the things I like to make sure I have on my holiday is an e-reader device and access to like a series. Cause if I blow through one, you like to be able to get, like, just pick up another one. And something somewhat not like, I don't mean like super trashy, but I was looking for, you know, like a new world to buy into because it's a nice escape from the current world. You know, you want to escape, you want to put your mind on an escape track when you're on holiday, as opposed to just enjoying the place you're in. No. So I started reading Leviathan Wakes, which is a novel by James S.A. Corey, which is the pen name of two people, Daniel Abraham and Ty Frank. It's the Expanse series, which has been turned into a Netflix show. I am not watching the Netflix show because I want to read the books first because I'm a big fat nerd. But it's a big kind of space opera. It does one of my favorite things, which is each chapter, like it just moves between these two characters. So one's a detective.
Yeah, right, alternating.
Yeah, and so it's just a nice view of the same situation. One of the things I've always loved about my favorite thing about the good Star Wars movies in my mind is that they are a really small window through a set of a few people's like points of view onto a much bigger conflict. And it's something I think that can often writers can kind of get, or TV shows or movies can get a little bit wrong around like huge worlds. It's like they feel like I have to set up the world and show us all the political factions, like go into all this depth through exposition, as opposed to just put me in the point of view of somebody who lives in that world and let them teach me about it through the things that they do and the people they speak to and the like the actions that they take and the way the world acts on them. And Leviathan Wakes does a really good job of that you kind of, the world unfolds and a story is woven, as opposed to like, here's the map and here is the ship schematics and this is all the factions that you need to know about and these are all the, you know, when you play a video game and they're like, make sure you read all the diary entries that you're finding. You're like, oh, fuck. Can't you tell me the story of the world through me playing through it?
Yeah. Don't give me homework to do. I just want to play a game.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Or like get to the action and, you know, don't tell me why. Like throw me in a little bit more. So Leviathan Wakes does a lot of that. I found especially into like the first act was great. The middle act where the conflict, the world gets a little bit bigger. But then the final act has been... it's gone in a completely different direction that I really, really love. It's not a spoiler. It's not like a plot twist or anything. It's just moving in a different direction, which is really great.
Cool.
Characters are really interesting and fun. I'm really enjoying it, reading well past my bedtime, and I'm looking forward to going into the rest of the series. So
awesome. Yeah. That's great.
Do you want to go one and one? We'll go back and one. Will you do one?
I was going to say, I've got two. We could trade off a little bit if you wanted. Okay, well, I got two recommendations then. The first one that I'll get into is... podcast. So, I mean, I know we're a podcast. Mm-hmm. This might be risky, but you know, I like to live dangerously. It's really good when you listen to a podcast and someone is a guest on that podcast and they go, good news, I've got a podcast. You go, great, I'm going to go another podcast I can listen to. But there's a guest called Chris Locke, who was on one of our favorite podcasts, Stop Podcasting Yourself, a little while ago. And he was like, hey, I have a podcast. And I was like, that sounds great. I'm going to check that out. And he's like, yeah. And then they were like, don't you have another podcast? He's like, yeah, actually I do. It's this one. So I was like, oh, cool. I'm sorted. So I checked them out and I really like them. One of them is called Happy Good, which it's like a guided meditation parody podcast, which that might not be for everybody. But I think honestly, if you've always dismissed guided meditation as like, you know, dumb, like this is crap. I don't want to talk about a fairy shitting on a leaf or something. Exactly. But honestly, listening to this, because it's just like it's just a guy improvising, rambling, weird nonsense stuff, which I always like. But then there's also like, he speaks very calmly and there's very calming music and it literally does have that same calming effect, but it's also an entertaining, funny, absurd, experience. So I really like that.
A bit of subversion. Like good subversion. Yes, I like that when someone takes a thing and puts the twist on it. It's like, it's a twist. It's like, no, it's still the thing.
Yes. It undercuts the thing while delivering the main benefits of the thing that I think it wins on two levels for me. Only because I've mentioned it. The other one that he does is called Evil Men, which is him and two other comedians, just talking about evil men. And sometimes it's Ivan the Terrible. Sometimes it is the latest one, I think, was Chevy Chase. So they did Dr. Doom. You know, it's like they don't take themselves too seriously. So it's a fun – that's another one. That's not my two recommendations. My main recommendation is Happy Good because I really like that one. But just because I mentioned the other podcast, that's the one he's on.
Three.
Exactly. All right, fine. Okay. Well, you can do three if you want.
No, I don't consume anything. So maybe I'm not going to mention Ted Lasso on the show again because you fucking hate it. And I'm not caught up. So I've got bad feelings about it now. After it won 45 Emmys,
you're in good hands. Yeah, I think that's right. Although I think that must have been for the last season, right? Because it wouldn't have been for the current season.
Yeah, well, no one at the Emmys is actually paying for Apple TV, so they haven't seen them.
That's true. That's kind of true. No, it's over to you for
regular terrestrial.
Are you, wait, is that your recommendation, Ted Lasso?
No, fuck no. No, no, my recommendation is Vigil on BBC. It is a murder mystery because someone dies on a submarine, and it's... And a detective from Scotland has to go and work it out, but they have to go in the submarine, and they're in the submarine, but also they have their partner. Okay. It is just, I was saying to my partner, not my detective police partner. That's a different
thing. Your detective partner life in crime, partner. In solving crimes.
Yeah. Although that would be the dream scenario. We've often talked about this. That like, my partner Amber loves detective shows and would love to be a detective, but we also love like food. So we're like, couldn't we, could we... Is there a television show where the food critic
cooking podcast?
Yeah, exactly. Something like this. Yeah, like we're trying to, you know, we're trying to get all the, you're trying to scrumble too many things together into one thing. But this show is kind of like that. I feel like they came up with the ideas of the premise or the all of the, because, you know, the standard procedure, I think, for coming up for a, like a new detective show or a new story around a murder or detective is you put limitations on the detective or the ways that they can solve the case. So it's like the person's been murdered, but the body is missing, or the detective only works in the morning because they've got a disease, which means they fall asleep. They've got narcolepsy or like some, you know, it's always a limiting factor somehow, right? You know, it's always the same, you know, they've got a drug addiction or not enough drug addiction. Like they're too easy. Yes, going, exactly. You know, something like that, you know, or their partner is the murderer, but for a good reason. All of these kinds of things. And it feels like that's exactly how Vigil was written, because it's like, okay, there's a death on a submarine. The person has to go there, but the submarine can't send information. It can only receive information. And that information is going to come from her partner, who's investigating on land, but only wants her to know the information, but everyone's going to be able to read the information submarine, so it has to come coded. And then it's going to be more than just like one death. It's going to be like also there's political implications too. And maybe the submarine's old, so things will go wrong on the submarine too, which will also get in the way of investigating the murder. And it just, I feel like they wrote all of that before we even start thinking about writing the show. Like before they even, like we're like, okay, is it going to be a murder? Who's going to be involved? All of that kind of stuff. They wrote all of the like the premise, I suppose, before they even started writing the show, which is fun. It's really great. I think it's annoyingly, I've caught up now. I think it's going to be like 6 or 8 episodes. And now I'm going week to week, and it's like, fuck, I hate week to week. Wish I could have just gobbled it all up in 2 days. But it's adding to the suspense, so it's good. Vigil. It's on BBC iPlayer. Get yourself a VPN and watch it. Or if you're in the UK and you can watch it, you should just watch it. It's good.
Excellent. I actually think I will check that one out. That one sounds really good. I was thinking...
And everyone's Scottish. It's a play the game of Spot the Game of Thrones actor, because they're all in it.
I've seen quite a few Scottish films with English subtitles, because the accents, it just confounds people apparently in the rest of the English speaking world. I thought you were going to say that it features some bewildering pronunciations of words or something like that, but I'm glad it was only about Game of Thrones. I won't have that problem because I've seen probably 40 minutes of Game of Thrones ever. So
hopefully I'm completely clear on that one. All caught up.
Yeah, that's what I decided to do, was just skip all of it and watch the last episode. Why wouldn't you do that?
Yeah. Everyone loves the last episodes. More recommend.
It's very true. They're always the ones that everyone's been waiting for. I figure they've built up all the suspense up until that point. That must be the best one. I've got one last content recommendation for you then. This is just a good follow. Good follow on probably particularly YouTube, maybe TikTok, maybe Twitter, but they all kind of link to the same stuff. A young guy called Tom Cardy, Australian guy, records songs in his bedrooms, records hilarious videos. He's hilarious. Big Breakfast, exactly. So I discovered him like a few months ago, and then like probably like 3 hours later, he really blew up. So I'm still holding on to this idea that I discovered him before he really blew up. But like now he's getting played on Triple J, and it's like, oh, this is very, like, that's why I'm introducing him at the first possible opportunity is like, if you haven't heard of him, go and check him out. But if you think he's already played out, then right. I'm very sorry. Incredible, just incredible comedic sensibilities and musical ability. He plays all the instruments and then appears in the video. It's just, a lot of them are just like montage, him standing in different spots in his bedroom, which is also hilarious. But just a really funny guy. Big Breakfast is a good one. I like Business Time and I like, it's called HYCBH. You'll get that when you watch that one, if you do watch it. Good stuff. Tom Cardy, like Tom Card, but with a Y at the end. Recommend him.
Very good. And if you want a little bit of insight into Australian culture, that is a good one to follow as well.
Oh, very much. And don't, you can't get hung up on use of the C word because it gets thrown in there occasionally, but tastefully, which is good. That's how we do it in Australia.
Of course. Tasteful C word. That is the whole country. Tastefully using the C word. Hi, I'm ministerial candidate Zach Priest, and I tastefully use the C word.
I tastefully use the C word. It's in his Twitter bio for the Prime Minister. One of my colleagues from the US came to visit us once, and he was like, is it true that you guys just walk around saying the C word all the time? And I was like, oh, yeah, absolutely. And then we went out drinking, and he was just walking down the street screaming it at everybody. I was like, nah, man, you got to pick your moment. Jesus.
I like that. We also don't like other plain things. Man.
Yeah. That's
true. It's powerful because of the way we use it.
That's exactly right. All things. Thanks for tuning in for another episode of Shakedown. I hope you enjoyed those content recommendations, and I hope that you won the Twitter poll in that way that you can win, because it's definitely a thing that can happen. Zach, we're going to go and record a little chat about Schumacher. So again, if you're in the Patreon, or if you want to join the Patreon, if you've always been Patreon curious, now's a great time to sign up, because you're going to get some fresh content coming straight at you. Any parting words, Zach?
No, not at all. I was a little bit concerned about my phone whilst we've been recording this because it was updating to iOS 15.
Don't even worry about it. It's fine. And I could hear you cracking open some kind of can earlier, so you're really having a good time there.
Yeah. Oh, this is a dear idea. It's Shakedown. I feel like I'm watching you. All bets are off.
It's all coming out. The dirty laundry. It's all getting exposed.
Cool. It's all exposed. Anyway, let's call it.
Next race is the Russian Grand Prix. If you don't tune in for the Schumacher episode, then we'll see you after the Russian Grand Prix. Have a good one. Valtteri Bottas is going to win. And until next time, my name's been Rod.
My name's been Zach.
And we'll catch you after that race. See you next time.
What's funny about that? What? I just said my name. Oh, God.
I don't know. Just deal with it. Is it me?
That's his already.
Oh, okay. Never mind. Sorry. Maybe I'm laughing.
I will wait for you.